Let's use the three steps to sketch method to get a nice graph of a pretty basic sine graph, y equals negative sine of pi over 3x. Now you might be looking at that pi over 3x and thinking, what's going on with this? This is going to be a complicated graph. It actually won't. I think it's easier than probably a lot of the others you've seen once you really break it down. So let's go ahead and jump in with our method. All right, here's our method outline, just so we can keep track of all our pieces and our steps. And here's a reminder of our equation and our grid. All right, we see our equation is in the form y equals a sine of bx. So we know that this is the right method to be using. And we can jump into step one, find the essentials. Start by identifying a and b. So you see a is an understood negative one. Okay, important things here. We know that the amplitude is just the absolute value of A. So the amplitude is just that distance from midline to maximum or midline to minimum. Of course, a distance can't be negative. That's why we take the absolute value. But I like to go ahead and put a little star here, circle, do something to mark it. We have a negative out in front of our function, which means it's going to be a vertical reflection or a reflection over the x-axis. So we know we'll take our base pattern later on, and we'll get more into this in a few minutes, but we'll take our base pattern and we'll flip it or reflect it. So I like to put a star there just to remind myself, hey, don't forget to reflect the function or use the alternate pattern. All right, so we have a, b we know is just the coefficient of x, so that's going to be pi over 3. Okay, a couple notes here. First, pi over 3, that's a number. And if you want to get an approximate for this number, a decimal, remember pi, of course, is just 3.14. So you're really taking a little bit more than 3 divided by 3. So this is going to be about 1 point, if you want a decimal to two places, about 1.05. Okay, so don't be intimidated by that pi over 3. It's really just a number close to 1. Okay, and B tells us several important things. Okay, first of all, I like to remind myself that B will be how many cycles happen between 0 and 2 pi. So we should have just a little bit more than one cycle happening in that space. Okay, B is also really important because we use it to find the period. And we do that by taking 2 pi and dividing by B. So let's write that out. To find the period, we do 2 pi divided by, since we're dividing by a fraction, let's multiply by the reciprocal. Okay, we'll rewrite 2 pi over 1. And you see, if we're going to cross cancel here, the pi's actually cancel out. So we're just left with 2 times 3, or 6. So our period is 6. And remember, period is just the length of one horizontal cycle. Okay, and that's what I was mentioning earlier. Pi over 3 seems like a really weird and intimidating B, but actually it cancels out the pi's when you're looking at the period, and you get to have a really nice number to work with. It also, let's go ahead and get into scale labels, it also makes the scale labels even easier. So remember, with this method, we purposely choose to design our scale in a way that's advantageous to us, and we are going to take our period and divide by 4 to choose our horizontal scale. Okay, so let's do that. We have 6 divided by 4. Okay, that reduces to 3 over 2. So we'll be counting by 3 halves. And the reason that we do this is because we know our method, and we know we're going to have 4 key equally spaced points in each cycle of sine. And because we divide our period into 4 equal pieces, each of our key points will align exactly with our horizontal tick marks. So it's a very intentional design. And it just makes for a nice, neat graph. Okay, for our vertical scale label, usually you can look to A or just use 1. That is the same thing in this case. So we'll count by 1s when we label our vertical axis. All right, let's go ahead and label our graph. So horizontally, we're counting by 3 halves. So that's 3 halves, 6 halves, okay, which of course is 3, 9 halves, and 12 halves, or 6. Okay, do a quick double check here. With this method, your fourth tick mark to the right of the origin should match your period, and it does. We feel confident that we're on the right track. our graph is going to really line up nicely, be a nice, neat graph. Okay, let's label the negative side of the horizontal axis. It'll be all the same, of course, just negative. And now let's label our vertical axis. Let's just count by ones. All right, step one is really the most in-depth step. You do all the analysis, you figure out all of your pieces, and then the next two steps are just putting them into place. So if you've done your work in step one, the next two should be easy and maybe even a little bit fun. All right, so let's move into step two, plot key points. And here's where we're really gonna come back. Maybe you even wanna, if you're writing out the steps, you wanna put your star right here. Our base pattern for sine is zero, maximum, zero, minimum. But that's for the parent graph, y equals sine x. If we have a negative with our graph, and we do in this case, all that means is our pattern, our base pattern, is going to flip or be reflected. So instead of having zero maximum, zero minimum, we'll have zero minimum, zero maximum. So basically the max and min just switch places. And that's because you reflected over the x-axis. Okay, so we still start in the same place. We start at the origin, okay? And we have our zero, and now we know it's going to be a minimum. And A also really helps remind us here, because our method tells us our next point should happen at our horizontal tick mark, our first one to the right, and then the y-coordinate should be the value of A. Well, our A is negative one, so that reminds us this should be a minimum here. Okay, our next key point will be another zero. It happens at the second tick mark from the origin to the right. And our final key point will happen at the third horizontal tick mark. And its y-coordinate will have an opposite value of A. And we know from our base pattern, this should be a maximum. All right, we have our graph. Let's go ahead and put one start to repeat the next cycle. That'll help us close when we're sketching in this sine curve. So we have a zero at six. All right, step three is to sketch and repeat. So let's sketch our reflected sine curve. Okay, we'll draw an arrow because it does continue. All right, so that is one cycle of sine. Okay, before we go and repeat, let's go back to B. Remember, B told us how many cycles should happen between zero and two pi. Well, our horizontal axis is not labeled in terms of pi, but we know 2 pi is just 6.28, so that should be about right here on our horizontal axis, about 2 pi. So if our graph continued, this green graph right here, you can see that from 0 to 2 pi that we marked in pink, we have a full cycle plus a little bit more. So it makes sense that B, pi over 3, told us that pi over 3 cycles should happen, or a little more than one cycle happened between 0 and 2 pi. So it's just a nice thing to double check, digging in deeper, analyzing, connecting a little bit more. All right, let's sketch one more cycle here. Go four tick marks to the left of your first point in the green cycle. And let's plot. We have zero, minimum, zero, maximum. You see, you're just repeating your exact green pattern four units shifted over. Okay, because sine is a cyclic or periodic function, it means it's repetitive. Okay. So now you have two cycles of y equals negative sine of pi over 3x. That's all there is to it. So practice a few of these using the three steps to sketch method. Everything will really fall into place. Everything will feel natural and like it just flows as you work a few more. Check out the links in the video description for more sine examples and also for some examples with other trig functions.